simply by sitting here improve children's services. So I have to have some discernible leadership skills and impact that you can measure. Up to now, there's been a strong focus on providing you with data and information in that way to measure what's happening in services. Data is useful. However, data in itself will not tell you what Ofsted are looking for when they come out to look at a child's file or a child's journey, because data will only measure whether something has happened or not. So for instance, we could tell you all of our assessments are now happening on time. That doesn't mean they're good quality. We could tell you that children are all being seen. That doesn't mean their social worker has spoken to them and engaged them and understood their position. So we have to use something more than just data to give us that information. From an Ofsted point of view, what we do is we triangulate information to give us a robust understanding of what is happening. So I would suggest we need to supply you with data, and then we need to triangulate that with evidence from audit, which will tell you what we found in looking at the case files. We need to provide feedback to you from families and children receiving the service, so as they give you another form of triangulating that evidence. We need to give you feedback from our staff as to how that has impacted on them. Again, another way of triangulating whether it's been achieved. And also from our partners. And you need to use all of those forms of triangulating the information you receive alongside the feedback from Ofsted and others to get a really robust view of whether or not we are delivering what we say we will.
Finance is something mentioned the personnel changes in terms of the improvement board, because of course we do know that Ms. Brazil has resigned as chair of that improvement board, and we have all seen that resignation email in which she says that the authority in its actions had put children's safety at risk. I was just wondering whether you could comment as to whether you think her resignation does impede the progress that the improvement board seems to be making.
I don't think it impedes. I think that what we've been able to do is to very quickly put something in place that will ensure that the stability of that journey, and that is Tony Crane, who's also the DfE advisor. So he knows the place, he's working alongside, he knows people, he knows the structures and the systems that we're working to, and he's prepared to take that forward alongside us. So I don't think that will unduly cause any delay or any
not only into scrutiny when we meet as a board, but part of everyday business in terms of getting things right for children and families in the rural.
Okay, thank you for that, Deborah. I've got a question from Moira.
Thank you, Chair. There are a couple of things I'd like to highlight. One is, I think you will know, and certainly those of us who sat on this very, very in-depth piece of work that we did, that we had a step change partway through
questions on this one. Obviously, I think in all of our minds is the CSE case that has recently been reported on. It's way through the criminal court, and thankfully the perpetrators are serving very long sentences at Her Majesty's pleasure. But in relation to that specifically, I think what will now follow is a serious case review. Will documents such as this be placed before that case review so they know that the council and the authority will look into the entire issue of safeguarding, perhaps when it might not be in the period of this particular case, but certainly when investigations were ongoing in relation to it?
The safeguarding review has appointed as a commission from the local safeguarding board an independent chair. So a safeguarding review will be generated through the local safeguarding board, and they've appointed an independent chair who's taking forward her review. She will speak to partners. She will ask for particular pieces of information. She will look at chronology. She will look at case notes. She will take the information that she requires to form her view on where we are. So it could be that she's asked for this. I wouldn't necessarily know that. But she will be taking on board where we are as the local authority, I would suggest, at this point, and making a view of where we are on that.
Thanks, Chair. On that then, is there a mechanism by which this can be forwarded to her, because she might not necessarily know the existence of the review?
There is. We can make sure that this is given to her as part of her just review.
By way of information, you may not know that I know that Ofsted used this report considerably when they were doing the first inspection. So, well informed people.
Yeah, no, that's good to know. I think it is a very comprehensive report, and I just think it would be good for her or him to have it in front of him or her when he's making the decisions on that one. But just looking a bit more deeply at the report itself, specifically, 16, which is on page 29, and it relates really to Maura's point, I suppose, her initial question. I welcome the June 2017 update where you talk about reality check visits, because I think they will be key in making sure that the recommendations are followed through here. But I would like to see them expanded not just with visits to practitioners, but also to partner agencies such as police, perhaps safeguarding leads in governing bodies, and you mentioned families there. Obviously, understand that we need to be careful when speaking to families directly, but it'd be good to get a view from them as to whether or not they believe that these various points have been achieved. Is that possible at all?
Yes, it's certainly something that we can explore and take forward and make sure that we've engaged in terms of the wider journey of the partners.
And we need to look at possible ways that people can communicate, because going out to see people is one way, but we might want to set up ways in which people can text in information, send in information, generally gather that information if they know there is a scrutiny committee happening. We publicise that, and I'm sure our partners will respond with comments about that particular area.
Yeah, through you, Chair, absolutely. I think that is a good idea. Perhaps Alan could assist us with that. I know he's done that type of thing previously for us for the scrutiny reviews. We should then move on to another point, but I think it's better.
Before you do, Paul, just on reality checks, we will be discussing that in the work programme at the end of the meeting. So, it's open for members to suggest whatever they'd like a reality check visit to take place, or you can go from there.
Yeah, it was just a point specific, I think, to this review to make sure that we are continuing to monitor the progress, given it is such an important topic that's up at this point in the agenda. But just finally, Jane, we'd like to hear a final point in relation to this particular report. Section 19 on page 31 talks about governance arrangements. I was surprised to note the presence in that report of the safeguarding reference group. It's a group which I'm not sure is still constituted. What's the progress of it? Is it now finished? I just want an update in regards to that. set up another one, which is the children's sports, which I think meets next Tuesday. So I'd just like some clarity around that, please.
It assists the update is split into two parts. The update from June 2016, what was in place then, that has now been disbanded, and the further update from June 2017 covers what's currently there.
Can I be of help as one of the people who's involved? What we thought at the time was there were quite a number of different groups meeting, and we didn't completely understand what each of the different groups was supposed to be doing. The children's reference group was one, safeguard reference group was one, we really didn't understand what they were about. And it was a duplication, it seemed, from doing anything, it was a duplication of what was being done elsewhere. And we did actually think it would be a good idea if that was probably not in existence. And I think that was the case, of course, it was actually disbanded following this. Not just because we said it should be, but because we just couldn't work out where it was doing all my research.
I think this about session in the first instance. I think there was an issue about sharing learning with members from serious case reviews, but then the rules were changed so that serious case reviews were published, because initially serious case reviews weren't published, there was only an executive summary, and I think some members felt they wanted more information, but then the rules changed and serious case reviews are now published, so in a sense the purpose for the committee was undermined by that really.
Any good questions, Paul?
No, that's all, thank you.
Okay, I've got Alan and then Wendy.
Thanks, Chairman. I just slightly, and maybe I'm being unfair in saying this, but I did slightly get the impression that this report, that some of the responses were done a little bit in haste, which partly I can understand, and I think I think every kind of touched on it almost, insofar as a lot of what's in here has been sort of superseded by other work, and the same, and probably whoever wrote this probably felt, well, I've answered these questions in another context. I'm not suggesting for one second, because I'm sure those who were on the committee, and it is a good piece of work, this, and we would want to come back and review it again. But I do think that potentially there's an opportunity, and I think this may be what you were kind of indicating before, an opportunity to roll this in with a more comprehensive, and it comes back to the sort of robust review that was mentioned earlier, to roll it into a more comprehensive report that covered this and all the work that is going on with the improvement board.
I think in terms of that, some of that would make it easier in terms of having everything in one place and being able to monitor and use the monitoring processes that we've got to do just that. But what we would need to be very careful of, that nothing is lost.
Yeah.
So if it is not a fair, if it is not a complete fit with what we're doing, then we wouldn't say, well, that doesn't fit, so it won't go forward. We would still need to review at that point when we refresh the improvement plan to make sure that it's either in and it's recognised as being within that, it's completed so it can come off altogether, or it's still an outstanding area of work that we need some attention to it to make sure that we don't lose it.
I suppose it's interesting when you've been part of a review, you read back to the original recommendations and you can remember some of the conversations that went on and some of the thought processes that were going on. So for instance, on page 21, it speaks about special guardianship arrangements. And the June 27 update, 2017 update, it seems to be referring to supports that are financial special guardians. And I would want to reflect that special guardians are often looking after young people who may have a multitude of needs and present quite a lot of challenges. I know of one incident in my own ward. And I wouldn't want it just to be allowed to fall backwards into just saying we're giving finance away. Because there is a lot more than that, and we know that I know. I think along the line, that was, I suppose, a comment, but maybe a question. New social work model. It would be helpful to have a group of members as well as for the frontline social workers, I think, so
same as other authorities, and there's this constant merry-go-round, and there's the same old recruitment of newly qualified social workers is effective. Of course, we've always been good at that, but as soon as they've been with us a short while, they move on to somewhere else. Now, anyone running a business will tell you that the retention of experienced staff is the absolute essential. You can't have a constant turnover of staff. In my region, my firm, our staff range from 45 years down, I think the minimum is 10. This is, like, if this was a new thing that came up, but it's constant, and I mean it. Again, I've heard this so many times. A review of social worker pay, progression, and retention is currently underway. So what strategies are we using to break this bad circle?
Okay. I agree entirely in terms of the comments that you make, Council, in terms of how hard that is, because we cannot do this job. We cannot get the right staff in the right places at the right time to meet the needs of children. We have been working tirelessly. We have a dedicated HR team that's sitting with us, and we've worked on a number of strategies. So we've got a workforce development strategy, for instance, because whilst there is a Care and Reward reaching its final stages, and we've looked at
partnerships with businesses in the area, like discounts and vouchers. Has that been explored at all, trying, rather than focusing on the pay structure, but looking at the benefits of employment as an authority, have we explored those aspects of benefits?
We have started to. We've started to look at it in terms of the kind of whole package. So there's a number of things that have been explored, not all come to fruition, but a number of things that have been and continue to be looked at.
What we're also just in the process of doing is because we have a number of schemes, it's very easy for members of staff not to be aware of all of the things that we already offer. So what we are doing at the moment is pulling those together into an offer that is easily seeable. When it is all on a sheet of paper, it's actually much more impressive and clearer for staff to understand what the offer is when they join us and to remain with us.
Okay.
Just following up on what Steve said before, I'm a new member of the committee. I did sit on the elder committee and did a piece of work on children. I'm sure Jill might join me to say we would really welcome some training in terms of the new structure, how it all fits together, the work of committees, because I feel a bit lost at the moment. Everyone talking about things, I have a lot of work. So I'd really be grateful for that.
Yeah.
I think so. For this.
Understanding what our social workers do and how they do it